Thank you, Dave, very much for the invitation. Thank you all for being here. You already heard a lot about Krefeld. Before I continue, I have to really be grateful to two people. First of all, to Martin, that you just heard, for his visionary monitoring that he set up more than 30 years ago, and the extreme thoroughness and documentation that he and his team accomplished over all this time. Now, the second person to thank is Kasper Hallman. And Kasper is my former graduate student. He's a brilliant statistician who's been dealing with these data, and without him, I would not be standing here. So, we already heard a lot about malaise traps. I don't have to introduce them to you. Big data set sampled over nearly 30 years, 63 different protected areas in Germany. And here we see, just very briefly, how that biomass was determined. Particularly this person, Heinz Swan, has been developing this method that Martin just described, and doing it over all this time in a very precise manner. So precise and so well documented that we could use it very well for our further analysis. So let me explain what our role was that involved. We were involved with the data analysis that we couldn't possibly do if it wasn't this well documented and collected. Now, basically, these 63 reserves, the majority fell into two broad categories that you see here. Either moist grasslands, fairly nutrient-rich. Here you see a drone picture in the early spring, where vegetation hasn't grown out, pretty a lot of flowers over there, and a lot of insects. On the other side, dry heathlands, nutrient-poor. And the difference between, let's say, the insect load in these areas could be an order of magnitude. So let's separate the two of them. Now, what did we do? What Kasper did was, for every bottle collected over these 30 years, reconstruct the weather under which that bottle was hanging on the malaise trap. He did that based on data from 160 different weather stations, integrating them in a spatial model to get the best estimates. And what we see over time is what you see here. It gets a little hotter in Germany, although there's a lot of variation. It gets a little drier over time, and there's also a lot of variation. Another thing we did is analyze the landscape. Martin already explained how important that is. Now, if you look very, very carefully, you can see a little red dot over there. That's the place where the malaise trap was in a very early phase and a very later phase. And if you compare these, we see what we generally see. Let's say, as far as landscape configuration is concerned, there are not very many changes occurring over these 30 years. We analyze them, pictures, and then you get something like this, and you do see a little change. As you can see here, the amount of arable land here around the trap in the early phase was reduced a little bit in the later phase. We got somewhat more forest. So there's a little change occurring. Otherwise, and we knew that from Martin and his group, these areas are generally well preserved. They are well protected. There's nothing really, something crazy going on as far as we can see at the moment. And then the model that Kasper developed gives this. What you see above zero, if a factor contributes positively to biomass, insect biomass development over the 30 years, below zero, a factor that contributes negatively to biomass development. What do we see? Temperature just a little bit higher up, it gets a little warmer, and all other things being equal, a little higher temperature in this region leads to a little bit higher insect biomass. Now, what else do we see? Trees are negative. This is an interesting one. Arable land is positive. More arable land is positive? No. Over time, we see that arable land has gone down a little bit in the surroundings of these traps, and that leads to a positive effect on insect biomass. Can we then explain the trend that we see in insect biomass? No, we cannot. there's a major unknown that we cannot grasp by the factors that we were able to quantify and relate to the insect decline. What that boils down to is this. What you can see here, the length of the bars represent the differences in insect biomass over the season. As Martin explained, they really measure biomass over their, almost over that entire season. And we see a decline in both of the sites over time. The model that we finally had captures that variation pretty well. There are some erratic years, mostly weather effects, as we all know. Some years were just much more favorable to insects, and others were unfavorable to insects. So we capture that erratic variation with the model. What is left is a steep decline in both types of habitats, leading to an overall estimate of -76%. And that's a number I think all of you have in your mind by now. So there's something going on here. Big decline. What else do we know about what's going on? A number of papers have appeared since. Largely, I won't deal with all of them, largely repeating, also giving, you know, significant decline. We are starting to look into, in the Krefeld desert, into the hoverflies. Very species group, rich group, very diverse. Work in progress, I cannot tell too much about it, but as it looks now, there's only losers. There are no winners. What we see is that all species decline in numbers, as you would expect, following sort of a random expectation. It isn't that one species is sort of playing this out and is increasing. It also seems that the persistence rates, particularly of the species of intermediate abundance, is much lower than expected. You know, these are the species that really disappear. And this paper came out last year, describes exactly that. And you see the title, Vanishing the Common Species. Now, this is something that is really weird. If you normally, you know, any environmental pressure, any hazard put on a system, what you usually see is that many of the vulnerable rare species are going down. But there are a few winners. There are a few, you know, that really profit from those new circumstances. It seems that that's not the case right here. It seems that the whole community is sort of going down. What environmental pressures now could be held responsible for that? Now, what we suggested early on, and here we, again we have a drone picture with the malaise traps in there. Typically, nature reserves have, you know, have a very sharp boundary. But insects can fly around, and influences are all over the place in relation to the farmland that's behind it. Now, one thing that can happen is this. Nitrogen, pesticides will percolate, will fly, will blow into or through the groundwater, flow into the nature reserves. And by now, I think there are really increasing accounts that also very low pesticide concentrations or nitrogen concentrations can really disrupt insect life, can disrupt the life cycle. Mineral balance is disturbed, mating is affected, survival, other aspects of reproduction. So it seems that that could easily play a role here, where nature reserves in Western Europe are by definition quite limited, and there's a lot of farmland around it. It's not the only thing. It also, there's a problem the other way around. Fly insects fly, and they disperse into what we can call hostile land, because this is how it looks like in the summer. We can have cornfields, we can have canola, that from a distance look really attractive, but in fact are a hostile environment, particularly if pesticides are being produced. And then the next nature reserve is very far away. Insects can't get there, they can't survive here. They cannot overwinter. Clearly, that is going to pose a really significant problem. So, where are we now? Three quarters decline. Pretty serious. All species affected. As our information is today, there's probably not a single cause. It's probably that combination between, say, widespread pollution of fertilizer, pesticide, but also the fragmentation and isolation of nature reserves. You know, particularly the last aspect, the fragmentation and isolation, has been on our minds for decades. We know that that's a problem. But we didn't know and didn't realize that the problem was this big. How can it be that entire communities are sort of completely decimated as a result of this? That is new information. All right, now what? What do we do? What's behind this? And what should we do to revert it? Now, the good news of this is the message has come across. Certainly in Europe, there has been big public concern about this. You don't have to be a bug lover to understand that if we lose all our insects, there is somewhat a problem going on. That has come across. It also has come across in, let's say, our organizations, our governments. On the left, you see a press release. In Germany, 100 million euros, which is about $100 million, a year has been released for insect protection plans and recovery plans. And it's, pretty impressive, actually, what has been planned there. On the right-hand side, you see Delta Plan for Biodiversity Recovery in my own country, the Netherlands, where we have worked with a whole group, including industry, farmers, nature organizations, scientists, together to make a plan to really structurally recover biodiversity. And the message has come across because, you know, it's not a single measure that is going to work. We really have to work on different things. If there are multiple causes, we have to come up with multiple integrated solutions. In both of these plans, that is understood. Now, we have to see what this brings us. Maybe in 5 years' time, here again, we all gather, you may know more. This is very exciting, what is going to happen now. And we need more data. In particular, we are experimenting with new monitoring ways. In this case, with monitoring through camera traps, with a camera that you see right here. And it gives very different information from malaise traps, of course. The malaise traps, and particularly the plans that Martin just exposed, is extremely important to get a better idea. It's probably the best way to quantify insects. The big advantage of doing it in this way is that we can involve landowners, people who have been changing their property in some ways, would like to know whether it has an effect. Put a camera there. And if it all works the way it does, it's still in the prototype phase, but if it all works, you know, they can see at night what has been flying around in that same day. And they can get a very good idea about what's going on in their property and whether their measures really work. So that participation, and Dan also mentioned that in his talk, is extremely important. And then with these new measures, high-tech measure, artificial intelligence, big databases behind it, it may all work well. And I think we can be optimistic that this is going to work. As you can imagine, with one-third of the country below sea level, dikes, water protection is a big issue in my country. Now, many dikes are sort of boring, green carpets with just a few grass pieces. But if you manage them in the right way, you get something that you see right here. It's a grassland with really loads and loads of flowers in there, wildflowers. Very attractive, very good for the dike, but also very good for insects. Now, Constance Winkels, my student, has been sort of pioneering here, looking at 45 locations, flower rich, flower poor, identifying wild bee species. To our surprise, he found 78 different species out of a total in our country of about 360 on a very small area. And indeed, what you see here is that the flower-rich locations have really much more wild bees than a flower-poor location with mostly grasses. We can really recover these populations if we do the right thing. And that is where it's all about. And that's where now, in our country at least, and in Germany, many people are involved with, and hopefully also here in the United States. So with a concerted effort, I think we can do it. We need much more research. We need much more research, but we really can work on this recovery right now. Thank you very much.